I am Mr. Ido Yao, the director of the UNESCO International Bureau of Education, IBE, based in Geneva. Founded in Geneva in 1925 as a center for international and scientific research, the International Bureau of Education has a long and rich history of intellectual leadership and the promotion of international cooperation in education. In 1929, under the distinguished leadership of Jean Piaget, who was director of IBE for 40 years, from 1929 to 1969, the IBE became the first intergovernmental organization in the field of education. From the beginning, one of the IBE's main activities has been the collection and diffusion of information. The IBE joined UNESCO in 1969 as an international center for comparative education, where it continued to promote research in the area of comparative education and education documentation and information services. Over the years, the core mandate of the IBE has changed. And in 2011, the UNESCO General Conference declared the IBE as a global center of excellence in curriculum. Founded to share knowledge and to stimulate the creation of new ideas, the impact of the Documentation Center has been substantial. It has inspired and supported education leaders, policymakers, scholars, educators in the development of education policies and shaping the intellectual history of Switzerland and the world. I am glad today to introduce this special book titled The IBE, A Matrice for Educational Internationalism. This book, based on a robust research on the IBE historical collections and edited by a team led by Professor Rita Hofstetter from the University of Geneva, highlights the important role the IBE played on a global stage as a cradle of global education as we know it today. It is the occasion for me to express my gratitude and thankfulness to Professor Rita and her team for this wonderful and outstanding achievement. This important collaboration with the University of Geneva will not only contribute to the growing body of research on the historical treasure we have in our documentation center, but also will help other international Geneva institutions and the Geneva International to learn about and interact with the IBE's historical collections. Thank you very much, and I wish you good reading of this book. Thank you.
recently published book entitled The International Bureau of Education, A Matrice of Educational Internationalism, is edited by Rita Hofstetter as well as the research team in social history of education based at the University of Geneva. This is the fruit of a highly collaborative process. There is an editing committee that gathers about 6 researchers as well as 17 contributing authors from different research labs. This first version, published in French, with its about 700 pages, recounts the history of the International Bureau of Education. Its PDF is available and accessible online thanks to the support of the Swiss National Science Foundation. So what is the book about? It's a complete study of the sociogenesis of educational internationalism during the 20th century from one of its matrices, the International Bureau of Education. At the end of the First World War, organizing a collaboration among all the states has become a necessity. While the League of the Nations was cautious about tackling educational matters, considered as the state's private affair, a group of intellectuals and educational psychologists gather in the International Geneva via the Rousseau Institute to create the International Bureau of Education. This bureau is first conceived to enhance reformist movement and to act as a documentation center for the educators around the world. Yet, in 1929, under the leadership of Jean Piaget, assisted by Pedro Rosselló and the General Secretary Mary Butts, the IBE adopts a new constitution and becomes the first intergovernmental organization to act upon educational affairs. After the Second World War, when UNESCO was created, this latter institution recognized the unique heritage constituted by the IBE. They both signed a partnership agreement and sealed their cooperation into a final agreement adopted in 1952. One of the main theses of the book is that the IBE, so far overlooked in historical research, is actually one of the precursors of UNESCO. From its creation, the IBE holds a posture of strict neutrality and objectivity. With this approach, the IBE aims to rally all the states of the planet to build a charter of the global aspirations of public education. The work conducted by the IBE and its member states evolves around topical causes which are defined sometimes not without resistance. It includes the right of juvenile populations, even the most vulnerable, to an adapted pedagogy and to a broad culture, school justice, equal opportunities, education for peace and critical thinking, and the improvement of teachers' working conditions and their training. Somehow, the IBE managed to mobilize numerous and increasing number of states. Nonetheless, while expanding the reach of its partners and audience, the IBE comes up against substantial contradictions. In this book, we explore a set of questions. So the book is structured into 3 parts. The first one is entitled The IBE, a Laboratory for the Institutionalization of Educational Internationalism. So basically, it's looking at the institutional development of the IBE and looking at critical phase and how the IBE managed to survive and gain into legitimacy. The second part is looking at the causes on IBE's agenda, meaning promoting the access for all to education in order to build peace. So we are exploring different educational thematics that the IBE is carrying out on its agenda and how states collaborate on such educational theme. The third part is about the network and the actors. And it's looking at the IBE into the constellation of international education. And it's looking at the partners' organization, it's looking at the connection between actors that are being made. We are looking at the trajectories as well as the profile of the actors in order to see how the IBE manage to place himself within this network of actors at the International Geneva in order to be recognized. Thanks to the rich archives conserved at the IBE Documentation Center, this work provides for the first time a behind-the-scenes look at the negotiation that took place within the office, and it sheds lights on several challenges that international organizations still face today.
The subtitle of our book is Matrice of Educational Internationalism. And matrix for us is a heuristic concept, which is very important in writing the history of the International Bureau of Education. The International Bureau of Education is a matrix in the sense as it is the first international institution which is founded around education. And that means exactly that it is a matrix. It is a matrix also in the sense that it is a precursor, for instance, of UNESCO. Of UNESCO, at least in the domain of education. Secondly, it's a matrix in the sense that the causes, the most important educational causes, are internationally discussed. For instance, causes like the access to education, access to secondary education, teacher education, but also things like, for instance, how to educate people in the way that they are international comprehensive, that international collaboration is possible, and that peace is also educationally founded. And thirdly, it is a matrix in the sense that the International Bureau of Education brings together people from all around the world, all countries that are autonomous, that have ministers of education, come together at conferences, publish books about very important educational problems, and this creation of international networks in order to discuss education problems is also the work of the International Bureau of Education, a matrix also in this sense.
I could say that the reception of a Brazilian person for the realization of this project reveals a desire of the team to be able to live during the process of book writing a little bit of what the IBE develops during his working years. It means that the integration of a foreign point of view, a foreign point of view that disturbs, that rearranges, that contradicts, and enriches the subjects in discussion. The participation of Latin American countries in the work of the IBE is quite remarkable. Ecuador was one of the first two countries to sign the new statutes of the IBE in 1929. It is a fundamental support for strengthening the international dimension of the institution. All Latin American countries participate at some point in the International Conference of Public Instruction organized by the IBE. They respond to the institution's service and they systematically report about their pedagogical progress, which are then published in the information bulletin of the institution. It is interesting that Latin American states use these international platforms in their own way. For example, to legitimize their educational reforms based on the principles of modern pedagogy. IBE becomes, for these countries, an ideal place to promote an image of the progress of public education in these young Latin American republics. However, an image very often does not necessarily correspond to their reality.
This is a landmark publication for many reasons, on which I want to make some short considerations. First of all, this volume offers interesting insights into the inner workings of international organizations during the first half of the 20th century. Drawing on strong empirical research, authors investigate the history of the IBE using a social history approach, which sheds light on the agency of individual actors. Chapters examine the trajectories and activities of IBE's founders, like Édouard Claparède, Pierre Beauvais, Adolphe Ferrière, and Jean Piaget, but also unveil the role of played by less known and subaltern actors. In doing so, the book brings new and critical insights into the history of internationalism and the mechanism of international cooperation. Second, the book reveals how the history of the IBE can be used as a field of observation for examining the evolution of educational policies in the West, but also elsewhere in the world, especially in Latin America. More particularly, it shows how issues such as equality, gender, curricula, teachers' training were debated internationally, and how national or local groups, associations, networks, and individuals tried to shape them. Third, this book is about history, but it's much more than a history book, because it leads to a better understanding of current educational problems. Founded in 1925, the IBE paved the way to a global educational governance, which will be later taken over also by other important organizations like UNESCO and the World Bank. Therefore, this book informs us on the way some important challenges were dealt with in the past, but also how contemporary stakeholders can learn from this past. For all these reasons, I think that this book will be of great interest to the global community of students and scholars working on education.